Hey everyone, my name is Vikram Shaw and I'm excited to walk through a general chemistry MCAT passage with you today. What we'll do is I'll walk through it and I'll give you some of my thought processes and how I would approach this passage if I got it on my exam. Ideally, you should take science passages in about 8 minutes, but we're going to take a little bit longer here and really take our time walking through it and hitting the main points. So without further ado, let's get started. All right, so we have a passage here, and upon first glimpse, one thing we can notice right off the bat is it's relatively short MCAT passage-wise. Sometimes, especially when it comes to chemistry, biology, psych, soc, it's possible to get a passage that's really three paragraphs long in one figure, which is, again, quite short when it comes to MCAT passages. So let's go ahead and get started. Carbon capture is essential for mitigating carbon dioxide emissions. Compared to conventional chemical scrubbing, electrochemically mediated carbon capture utilizing redox active sorbents, such as quinones, has been increasingly studied by researchers. However, the practicality of such systems is hindered by the requirement of toxic, flammable, organic electrolytes, or costly ionic liquids. So, on first glimpse, reading through this paragraph, it seems a lot like background info. We might need to know it, but it seems really just introducing this subject of carbon capture. And one other kind of buzzword, a couple buzzwords we saw, electrochemical and redox. Redox is a really high yield MCAT term, MCAT subject that they like to test us on that you might see later on. So that's something we want to keep our eye on. In a novel study, researchers tested whether rationally designed aqueous electrolytes with high salt concentrations could effectively resolve the incompatibility between aqueous environments and quinone electrochemistry for carbon capture. I read that sentence and I didn't pick up anything. That was a really confusing sentence. So let's go back. On your test, you can maybe go back and reread that sentence quickly to try to glean some information. But here, let's go back and let's take a little bit more time. So in a novel study, this is the kind of experiment that the passage is talking about with us. Researchers are testing whether rationally designed aqueous electrolytes, so they're testing these rationally designed aqueous electrolytes with high salt concentrations. So I think it seems like our independent variable could effectively resolve the incompatibility between aqueous environments and quinone electrochemistry for carbon capture. Really, this is a lot of words. At this point, I don't 100% really know what's going on, but it says there's some incompatibility. So we're testing these aqueous electrolytes with high salt concentrations to resolve some incompatibility. That seems like kind of our dependent variable. Reactive quinones can capture carbon as shown in figure 1, but they may also undergo undesirable side reactions such as protonation or ion association. So now let's walk through figure 1A. Using the TADP approach title, let's look at what the title says. Quinone-mediated carbon capture. Okay, so we see that. That's kind of what they also introduced in the second paragraph. We have these quinone molecules, which if we go back up here, these quinone molecules are being increasingly studied by researchers as carbon capture molecules, right? And so that's an interesting point. So that's kind of the framework we're building, right? And at this point, you can see we don't have 100% perfect grasp of this knowledge, and that's what the MCAT is designed to do. They're going to give you situations, scenarios, passages that you don't feel 100% comfortable taking. But that's the challenge of the exam, and that's what we're going to try to work through here and show you how you can use the existing framework, the existing knowledge you do have, and apply it to these new situations. Okay, so let's go through panel A. So here we have our quinone molecule. So this is our quinone. And there's kind of a multi-step reaction. So we add two electrons. So at this point, pause this video. What is it, and answer this question. If we're adding two electrons to this quinone molecule, what process are we doing? Are we oxidizing or reducing this quinone molecule? And so pause the video, answer it. Once you've answered it, let's come back. And so if you answered reducing, you are absolutely correct, right? We are adding electrons to the molecule, therefore reducing it. So we have an oxygen with a negative charge there. And so now it looks like there's three potential pathways. So in pathway one, we can add a CO2, a carbon dioxide. And so essentially we're adding a carboxyl group to that oxygen that we reduced, right? So that's that first pathway. In a second pathway, we're protonating that oxygen. We're adding a hydrogen atom. And in the last pathway, we have ion association. So we have a positive ion associating with that negatively charged oxygen. So those are three different pathways that we're taking. And so now let's look at figure B. And one of the challenges of the MCAT is seeing figures that are quite complex like this one. And so let's try to get as much information as we can in 10 to 15 to 20 seconds. And then if they ask you a question about this figure, then you can come back and look at it in greater detail. So title, we're still under this kind of quinone mediated carbon capture. And so again, TADP, let me write that here. TADP, title, axes, independent variable, dependent variable, patterns. So our x-axis is potential. And so that's also our independent variable. So we're measuring some sort of potential. And our y-axis is current. And so that's going to be our dependent variable. So we're measuring potential versus current in this condition. So we have 0.1 molar of, looks like, some solvent, 5 millimolar AQ, 1 millimolar FC. They haven't really told us too much about that in the passage. So if they were going to ask us a question about it, they would have to give us some background information. And so that's an important thing to know. And patterns. So it looks like they're testing, and so we can see a closed loop, it looks like, for two independent variables. There's nitrogen and there's carbon dioxide. And really, there's very little without kind of having a question attached that I can get from this figure, right? I've never really seen a figure that looks like this. I don't 100% know how to approach it. But I do know there's a closed loop, and the curves differ only at a few points, right? The curve differs here from nitrogen and carbon dioxide, right? Those points, oops, sorry. This point and that point differ, right? So maybe that has something to do with the independent variable of potential. So at a potential of minus 2.0, the nitrogen and carbon dioxide have different values, right? And they really look to have different values throughout this portion. Okay, so again, I've really never seen a figure like this. I'm not sure if I analyzed it 100% correctly, but we haven't yet been asked a question. So in practice, on your actual exam, on your practice exams, you'll spend 15 to 20 seconds looking at a figure, going through this TADP method, but they might not ask you a question about that figure. Okay, so now let's finally go to our last paragraph. The researchers measured quinone-mediated carbon capture in several different salt solutions, such as NaCl, KCl, Na2SO4, and NaH2PO4. In an experiment varying the NaCl concentration from 1 molar to 10 molar in increments of 1 molar, researchers found a maximal rate of carbon capture at 6 molar sodium chloride, after which a steep decline in carbon capture was observed. Okay, so I think this is a super important paragraph. So one thing is we now finally have independent and dependent variables that we can hang our hat on, right? So several different salt solutions. So that's a series of independent variables, right? And then what are they measuring as a dependent variable? And I'll give you a couple seconds to think about that. Carbon capture, right? So researchers are measuring carbon capture. They're measuring carbon capture at these different salt solution levels. And so that's what is super important, and that's what we need to be paying attention to on this for this final paragraph. Okay, so now let's move on to our questions. And I'll change the color here. I like that one. Okay, which of the following best explains the decrease in carbon capture after 6 molar sodium chloride? So let's go down here. Okay, right, this is where that comes up, right? They talked about this maximal rate of carbon capture at 6 molar NaCl. So let's draw our own graph real quick, right? So we have carbon capture on the y-axis, right? That's our dependent variable. And then we have sodium chloride concentration. And what they're telling us is it goes up something like this, right? Goes up, 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 up. And then at 6 molar, there's a steep decline. So that's what we know so far. And now the question is asking us why. Why is it doing that? What information do we have from the passage that can tell us a little bit about what's happening here? And so we know that we were talking about quinone-mediated carbon capture, right? Which of these three, one, two, or three, which is capturing carbon? And it's gonna be this first pathway, right? We have this carbon dioxide, and actually let me just do this top part. In this reaction this way, we are capturing carbon, right? Now, what other side reactions are there that would prevent us from capturing the carbon, right? So those are the other side reactions that we need to be aware of. So so let's look at this. So we have protonation, right? And that can decrease the amount of carbon capture that's occurring. And ion association can also do the same thing, right? That can also decrease the amount of carbon capture that's occurring. So in this case, if we're seeing a decrease in carbon capture after 6 molar NaCl, what we're gonna do is we're gonna be producing a ton of the sodium ion. So odds are that we are having a lot of ion associate with our reduced quinone, and that's decreasing the amount of carbon capture that can occur, right? So we're going down this pathway 3 when we have a ton of sodium chloride. So that's gonna be our guess. So let's look at answer choice A. The solution became too acidic. So that's addressing the other pathway. That's addressing protonation, right? And what we saw earlier is that, essentially the trap here is that it's 6 molar sodium chloride. Is that gonna make it an acidic solution? And the answer is no, right? So A is going to be incorrect. Now let's look at answer choice B. The quinones associated with the ions due to the high concentration of the sodium. That's exactly what we were saying, right? We're going to go down pathway 3 instead of pathway 2 or 1. The high concentration of sodium sequestered the carbon instead of the quinones. So here they're saying that Na is binding directly to the CO2. And is that supported anywhere by this passage, by the figure? And the answer is going to be no. And finally, answer choice D, the quinones were protonated quickly due to the high salt concentration. That kind of goes along with A, right? Salt is not going to produce an acidic environment. So answer choice D is going to be incorrect here. And our correct answer will be B. Okay, let's look at question 2. The addition of a carboxyl group to a molecule is known as, and so this is an example of a question that could really stand by itself, right? It doesn't really depend upon what's happening in the passage. And so this is kind of a memorization question. And the addition of a carboxyl group to a molecule, similar to what's happening here, is known as carboxylation, right? Carboxylation. Let's look at question 3. The researchers optimized the correct salt solution for their experiments, but they still measure a high amount of quinone protonation. Which of the following steps would most likely reduce quinone protonation? Okay, so let's break down this question. So the research, and let's break it down in terms of pathway. The researchers say that they don't have to worry about side reaction 3, right? They optimize the salt concentration, right? And now we're left with pathway 1. Pathway 1 they want, so let me do that in a better color. Pathway 1, they want to happen, right? So this is what is desired. but they're still getting too much of pathway two. They're still getting too much protonation. So what can reduce quinone protonation? And so the way I think helps me think about protonation in general is actually using Le Chatelier's principle, right? So let's say in solution, let's say we have, and I'm just going to simplify this molecule. I'm going to draw out this part of the molecule. Let's say we have this molecule here, right? And we can add a hydrogen ion to produce this molecule, right? So this is equivalent to side reaction 2. And what do we want to do? We want to decrease this, right? We want to decrease the rightward flow, and therefore we want to decrease the amount of product that's produced, right? What, using Le Chatelier's, how can we do this? One relatively easy way is to just decrease the amount of hydrogen, right? What's that going to do if we were thinking about, again, about Le Chatelier's principle, is that's going to force this reaction to go this way. You're then going to decrease the amount of this protonated product that we don't want, right? So we decrease hydrogen ions. And what does that mean in terms of pH? We want to increase the pH. And so I think this is hopefully an easier way to think about pH and protonation, especially because, you know, raising the pH is the same as decreasing your hydrogen ion concentration, all of these things. It can get confusing. But I think Le Chatelier's principle, especially when you draw it out, is an easier way to think about it. And finally, let's go to question 4. Which of the following best describes the first forward step of the reaction shown in figure 1? And this is actually a step I had us pause and think about a little bit. And we're adding 2 electrons to the quinone. And so what is this going to be? This is going to be reduction. Okay, awesome. So you can see as we walk through that passage, and you'll see this on the MCAT, we had kind of a medium level question. We had maybe an easy to medium here. And then we had a hard question here, right? This one is more challenging. And then finally, we had an easy to medium question here. And a lot of times, and you'll see a couple points here. One, we didn't get a question on figure B, which was good because it was a more difficult figure. And two, there was a mix, right? There was a mix of questions that could have been asked by themselves. There was a mix of questions that were based on the figure. And there was a mix of easy, medium, and hard questions. And so it's important that you're not leaving points on the table when it comes to those easy questions that really just require you to know what carboxylation is. But it's also important that you're able to apply principles, you know, right? Like Le Chatelier's principle to information you're given in the passage. And so I really hope that you enjoyed this video. I hope you got something out of it. And we were so happy and excited to start bringing this series to you. So with that, please don't forget to subscribe and sign up for our question of the day at the link in our description so you can get every last bit of practice in before your exam day. Best of luck with studying, and we'll see you on our next video.